Peter's life is possibly the most excellent redemption story ever written. He was a fisherman, and fishermen were stereotypically men of action, very physical and unafraid of others, which Peter demonstrates in the Bible. Yet this simple fisherman's journey to an apostle of Christ is found in the precious New Testament. It is tough to capture the impact of Peter's life in a single video, because his legacy is rich in knowledge and relevant messages. However, Peter faced a significant challenge, as the devil had a mark on him. And Jesus informed him of this, to give authority to this dilemma. At the Last Supper, Jesus warned Simon Peter that a test of faith was coming. "Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you, that he may sift you as wheat." Luke chapter 22, verse 31. The outspoken disciple appeared to be in a difficult situation. Satan desired to sift Peter's wheat, which means he wanted to shake Peter's faith so violently that he would fall, demonstrating that God's faithful servant was lacking. But it wasn't just Peter who was in danger. In Luke chapter 22, verse 31, the word for you is plural. Jesus was telling Peter that Satan had set his sights on all of the disciples. Some translations, like the Berean Study Bible, specify the entire group. "Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift each of you like wheat." This passage gives us a glimpse into an unseen world. It raises many questions, but it also affords many assurances, the chief of which is the chain of command. God is clearly in control, and the devil is on a short leash. Did you notice the verb that followed Satan's name? Ask. Satan has asked. The outspoken disciple seemed to be in the same predicament as Job when Satan sought to put him to the test in Job chapters 1 and 2. Job chapter 1, verse 10. "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands, so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." The devil did not demand, resolve, or decide anything. He inquired. He asked for permission to tempt Simon Peter in the same way he asked for permission to tempt Job. Doesn't recast our image of the old snake? God will use all beings for the sake of his kingdom. The name Satan means adversary or accuser. He accuses God's people of doing wrong. Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1. "Then the angel showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, with Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him." As Peter later testified, the devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Sift as wheat is a metaphor that can also mean shake someone apart or break someone down. Amos chapter 9, verse 9 gives us a similar image of God shaking Israel. "For surely I will command, and I will sift the house of Israel among all nations, as grain is sifted in a sieve, yet not the smallest grain shall fall to the ground." Wheat or other grain was sifted through a sieve or large strainer in biblical times. The dirt and other impurities that clung to the grain during the threshing process would separate from the good, usable grain as it was violently shaken. Satan's goal in sifting Peter and the other disciples as wheat was to crush them and destroy their faith. In reality, the adversary seeks to destroy every believer's faith. John chapter 10, verse 10. "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." However, Jesus assured Peter, "I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith should not fail. So when you have repented and turned to me again, strengthen your brothers." Luke chapter 22, verse 32. Peter's role as a leader in the early church demonstrated that the Lord's prayer for Peter was answered. Jesus did not promise to take away Peter's upcoming test. He prayed that his faith should not fail. In the Christian life, trials are to be expected. We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God, say the missionaries in Acts chapter 14, verse 22. God uses these experiences to shape our character, strengthen our faith, and make us more like Jesus. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 to 7. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than the gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. James chapter 1, verse 12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Romans chapter 8, verse 29. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Whenever we go through a test, Jesus is with us to strengthen us and intercede for us. Romans chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen. Who is even at the right hand of God? Who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities nor powers, nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength.